Good morning, Coach. How are you, buddy?
Hey, Coach.
Oh, good morning. Good morning. Thanks for having me on. How are you guys doing?
Doing great.
We're doing great. Coach, I want to commend you, for putting your team out there the other night. I was out of town. I really wanted to come watch you guys practice. But I think a lot of, and I'm not being critical of other coaches, but I think too many coaches, and I think even in the SEC, are so paranoid about putting their team out there in front of everybody, like there's some big secret out there in basketball. So I hope that you enjoyed. I know you can't do that every time, but I wanted to thank you for putting your team out there, because you guys got a lot of buzz going on right now, and I think more basketball coaches in the SEC need to do that. I just want to get your comment on what happened the other night there.
Well Barry, first of all, you're going to have another opportunity, because we're considering having another open practice on the day of a home football game. And we think, with our 38,000 students on campus and everybody excited about going to the football game, that if we have another open practice at Coleman when the campus is buzzing sometime in September, that we can potentially double or triple the amount of fans that came out and supported us in August, when we don't have many people on campus. It was a tremendous success. It exceeded all of my expectations. So we're considering having another one on a home football weekend. And we're also going to have our Tide tip-off event, which is October 24th. I don't think it's molecular biology, or my daughter studied Mandarin Chinese in college. This is not rocket science. This is basketball.
Thank you.
And, you know, I just think, if we're going to continue to grow our program, building that relationship with our fan base is going to be critical. And the one way that you build it is giving them access. And we have a lot of fans and donors and Tide Tuscaloosa tip-off members that stop by practice. We take donors on the road with us. So we think building that relationship is very important. And that come from a customer service-driven business called the NBA. So that's something that's very important to us.
Yep, Dan.
Coach, I think that naturally the games are important to you, but I would guess that the practice time is even more important than that, because it gives you an opportunity to sort of mix and mingle, take a different look at different ways, different kids, play with different kids. But and certainly the games are good. Anytime you play against somebody that else besides yourself, that's good. But I think the practice times that you've gotten out of this should be really beneficial to you.
Absolutely. When we get 10 days of practice, and they're called 10 days, they're not necessarily 10 practices. So there's some flexibility there. So the practices have been outstanding, because we're able to just see how we can coach these guys. And, you know, some of these guys, a lot of these guys are just different in terms of their personality. Now, we got a lot of talented kids. We have more talent than we've had in 2 years combined on this team. But, guys take coaching in different ways, and, you know, you're just trying to figure out the different levels of coaching and what type of voice you have to use with a lot of these kids. We have 5 freshmen. They all come from different backgrounds, and they've had all different coaching experiences. And so this practice time has been critical for us to be able to figure out how we reach our kids and how we get the best out of them. It's all about getting them to maximize their potential, because if they maximize their potential, our team's going to be better. People always talk about there's no I in team, but there is an I in win. And the only way we win is these kids dominate their individual matchups and play together and unselfish and trust each other and play well together collectively as a team. But we can't play well as a team if they don't maximize their potential.
Yeah, that's right, Barry.
We're talking to Coach Avery Johnson. Coach, obviously when you come in, you have a team here, and you've always said those are your guys, but you got to look at them and say, okay, this is how we have to play for this team to win. Now that you're in year three, do you have a style in your mind, and you tell your staff, hey, let's go recruit this type of guy? Obviously, you're going to take the best player you can get. Or do you say, hey, we'll just take this team, let's practice with them, let's see what this team can do. I want to press, I want to play fast, but let's make sure these guys can do that, and kind of determine your philosophy with that team based on what you see they can do.
Yeah, you're right, Barry. When I first came in, you know, especially coming, you know, with my background and all of the talented people on the NBA level that I'd been around, and looking at the landscape of college basketball, we want to play fast. And, you know, I like to press more. And let's get up and down the floor. We don't want to walk the ball up the floor. We want to be able to get the ball up and down the floor and play at a high level of speed. And, you know, obviously you got to take care of the basketball. But when I first got here and I looked at the team, thinking, man, how can we even win five games? And, you know, just the roster was just depleted. And at the end of the day, we had one guy in Rhett Novasahin that could score the ball for us, and we didn't know how well he was going to be able to score it because he really didn't have a significant role for the 3 years prior to us getting here. But he overachieved, and we rode him as best that we could. And in year two, we had a few more players with Braxton Key and Dejon. He was finally healthy. But at the end of the day, we had to be a defensive team these first 2 years because we felt that's the best way that we had an opportunity to win. In year three, we think we have, you know, some more talented offensive players that have joined us, whether it's Daniel Giddings, you know, who can help us a little bit more inside scoring with his size and strength and speed. And a lot of our freshmen are all really good passers and shooters and decision makers. So we hope that our turnovers, which have been significantly high in years one and two, can be reduced so that we can have more opportunities to score the ball. And hopefully our point production and our offensive efficiency will increase, which will make us a better team. And we can eventually get to that style of play that I was hoping for.
Coach, on this Canada trip, are you going to go over there and start one group the whole time? Or are you going to look at different combinations of starting over there when you guys get over there and play?
Yeah, we're going to look at different combinations. I don't think you'll see the same team start all three games. We have an idea. Well, I know who I'm going to start rather than the first game. But then we'll just kind of be flexible after game one. But we like to start, you know, we don't want to start the same lineup every game and look at different rotations. That's what this is all about, because eventually, Barry, when we get to November, I don't want to have to experiment with rotations. Yep. You know, I felt that's why we've kind of been behind a little bit early in the non-conference, because we've been experimenting too much because we just didn't really know what we had. But I think because of this exhibition games and all of the practices that, like Coach Wimp alluded to, we'll have a better idea of what we have, so that once we get to November in that first game against Memphis at the Naval Academy, we'll be set a little bit more in our rotation, our strategy for how this team needs to play.
Yeah,
you got a really good non-conference schedule. I think it's a mixture. I like a mixture of, you know, some tough teams and of some other teams that you can look at your team a little bit more with. So I think it's good. Of course, the way the league is doing now, you got to play five teams twice, which I guess if it's the right if it's right five, you're okay. But the conference schedule is a little bit different. I'm not sure it's completely fair for everybody, but it is what it is. But I think your non-conference schedule is very good.
Absolutely. I think it's very competitive. When you look at, you know, going to Arizona and, you know, playing Minnesota, who could be a top 25 team. Arizona's probably going to be a top five team. You know, Oklahoma, we're part of the Big 12 SEC Challenge now. So we're playing some tough teams. But that's a part of trying to build our resume so that we can be much more attractive to the NCAA committee. When tournament time rolls around, you look at Vanderbilt made it to the tournament with 15 losses last year. Here we're sitting 19-14, but supposedly our resume wasn't as good. So again, we're going to try to win as many games as we can, but we're trying to put, we thought we put together the most competitive schedule that we've had in non-conference since we've been here. And from what I've heard, this is probably the strongest non-conference schedule that they've had here probably in the last 5 or 10 years. So we think, you know, with the emergence of our team, our returning players who are critically important to the success of our team, we thought it was time to take that next step forward. And hopefully we'll win our share of games and have an opportunity to make it to the tournament.
We're talking with Coach Avery Johnson. Coach, I've seen pretty much all your fresh. We've heard a lot about those guys. Tell us about Daniel Giddens. What type of post player is he? Just tell us about and how has he done so far here getting ready for the season?
Well, he's improved. When he arrived on campus, Barry, he was only 225 pounds. Now he's 245 pounds and solid. And he's, you know, we think he could be a force for us inside. He's probably one of the faster big men for his size in the country. You know, he can really get up and down the floor. But, you know, when you look at Daniel, the muscle that he can provide inside, he's got some pretty good jump hooks with his left and right hand. He's a really good passer. You know, you look at even where the game is going now, all of the teams that are successful in the tournament, their big guys can pass the ball, and Daniel is a really good passer. So combining Daniel with Dante, and Dante's emerging, man. He's coming. He's getting better. Sometime I'll play those guys together. Sometime I'll play Daniel behind Dante, and both of them will play five. And like we did with Jimmy and Bowler last year, we think these two guys will be even more talented and more effective inside. But Daniel's, he's improved.
Just tell us kind of the itinerary for this Canada trip. I know there's a lot of fans excited. I think a couple of y'all's games are going to be streamed, so I know we'll get a chance to watch those. But just kind of tell us about the trip and when you guys are leaving and all.
Yeah, so we'll leave today from Coleman Coliseum late afternoon, and we'll drive over to Atlanta and spend the night there, and then we'll fly to Montreal on tomorrow at noon and practice Saturday night. We'll practice Sunday afternoon, and then we'll play our first game against McGill on Monday at 6 o'clock, and I think that's one of the games that's going to be live streamed. And then we'll travel over to Ottawa and play two games back to back on Wednesday and Thursday against Carleton, which, by the way, is a team that has had a lot of success against the American schools. You know, they beat Wichita State. I think they beat USC or Indiana a couple of years ago. So they're really a tough team. And then we're going to finish up with the University of Ottawa on Thursday. And this was a calculated strategic move for us because we wanted to play against older teams that are experienced, that have had a lot of success against American schools. I didn't want to go on a foreign tour where you're going to be basically Barry Wimp playing a YMCA team, and you're not going to get anything out of it. So we wanted to go somewhere where they had the best competition, not too far away from home, so that when the trip concludes, our players will be able to come back and have about 10 days at home with their families.
Yeah.
I appreciate everything you've done. I appreciate you allowing them to put the North Carolina game on. I enjoyed watching it again, and I appreciate everything you've done. Hopefully, you're going to have a great year.
And Wimp, just remember now, when the SEC schedule comes out, you pick your game. We love okay. when you come on the road with us. It really means a lot to us, the way you've embraced my coaching staff and I. You know, those guys that I work with every day, you know, your assistant coaches mean a lot to you. We just hired a coach, Yasir Roseman. Of course, you know Petway and Pelfrey. But it means a lot when you come to practice and when you join us for a road game. So just pick a game. We love to have you. And, Barry, you know you're welcome anytime. And we just thank you guys for all your support.
Yeah, well, I appreciate it. Cause, yeah, I enjoyed watching that North Carolina game as well. They're a pretty good recruiter when you got David Benoit and Keith Askins coming off the bench. That's pretty good recruiting, isn't it, Coach?
I don't like to play with bad players.
Yeah, them guys on the bench.
As Bill Belichick and Coach Greg Popovich about that and Phil Jackson, they'll tell you their plays work a whole lot better with problem solvers than good players.
Thanks,
Coach.
Right,
that's
guys.
A great
Thanks
trip.
A
I'm taking
time.
It. You guys be safe over there, and we'll look forward to watching you guys play over there. Good luck to you.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Roll Tide.
Thank you.